On today's episode of You Asked, On the Road Edition, it's all about acronyms and the troubles folks are having with them. ABL on OLEDs, APL, how HDR and WCG are not one and the same, MLA panel technology, and of course, eARC. Welcome back, everyone. I'm Caleb Dennison, and this is You Asked on the Road Edition, the show where I answer questions you asked in hopes that I can help you and others with similar tech questions. If you have a question you'd like answered, please email it to youasked@digitaltrends.com, and we'll see if your question gets picked to be answered on the show. Now, as you can probably tell, I'm traveling, and I'll be traveling for a couple of weeks. So I'll be doing a few shows from various hotel rooms in New York City. If you hear honking horns, emergency vehicle sirens, or aggravated pedestrians in the background, kindly do me a favor and forget about it. Hey, when in New York, right? So hey, last week's topic-based episode was a lot of fun, and a bunch of you hopped into the comments section to weigh in with your thoughts on all matters 8K. So thanks for that. For this week, I'm a little cramped for time, but I still wanted to do a topical theme if I could. So today's questions will involve acronyms, which, to be frank, ain't that difficult to stick to because tech in general loves its acronyms and AV has more than its fair share. If I do this right, we can answer some viewer questions while also explaining what these acronyms mean, enabling you to be a more savvy shopper. Good times. All right, let's get into it. First question comes from David Cobham in Ontario, Canada, an ice hockey fan who is concerned about ABL, which stands for Auto Brightness Limiter. David is leaning toward an OLED for his new TV, but is confused about whether ABL applies to SDR content, specifically hockey. The last thing he wants is for all that gleaming white ice to cause his TV to dim when he's watching matches, which I gather he does a lot. Thanks for your question, David. First, I'm gonna explain ABL, and then we'll get to your specific concerns. Auto Brightness Limiter is a feature that was created for OLED TVs. The O in OLED stands for organic, and as organic beings, we are very familiar with the biological imperative that is aging and death. Sorry to go dark. The organic compounds that make light in an OLED TV do wear down over time, and just as stress accelerates aging in humans, it also accelerates the degradation of the organic compounds in an OLED TV. In other words, the harder you drive an OLED TV, the faster it will wear out. To prolong the life of OLED TVs, an auto brightness limiter algorithm detects when an OLED TV is being driven hard for long periods of time. That qualifier is important. Then it reduces the brightness of the TV automatically. Now, the good news is that as OLED TV tech has advanced, auto brightness limiting has been relaxed quite a bit. But if there's one type of content that you can count on to trigger ABL, it's hockey, which has a lot of bright white light in it. And unfortunately, hockey tends to make an auto brightness limiter more obvious because our eyes are sensitive to reductions in white light brightness. Now, over the years, I've tried to include an ABL test in my reviews, but it's less urgent an issue these days than it once was. I suppose I should consider stress testing every OLED for ABL, but I just don't see it in most types of content anymore. But let's now answer David's question. Does SDR content trigger ABL? And the answer is yes, it absolutely can. In fact, ABL doesn't care whether you're watching SDR or HDR. It cares about how bright the TV is being asked to be. There's this notion that HDR content is universally brighter, and that is absolutely not the case. HDR unlocks more dynamic range, and yes, that means that the brightest brights can be brighter, but HDR content is not brighter all the time. In fact, some folks complain that HDR content is actually more dim than they'd like it to be. So David, it really depends on how bright you set up your OLED to be when it's playing SDR content. If you max out the OLED light level, you crank up the brightness setting, or you turn on features like peak brightness set to high, then your SDR content will have a high average picture level. That's APL, which is way too close to ABL. With that said, I don't think you'll find that watching hockey necessarily means your TV is going to be constantly dimming. The TV is going to get enough breaks when it shows players' uniforms, the crowd, and the commentators. That way the TV is less likely to get triggered. Now, if you pause on a very bright moment in the game, you would see the image dim slowly over time. I'm talking about minutes here. But this issue where the TV slowly dims over time and never brightens back up, if you've heard about that kind of thing, that's a bug that was found in a very few TVs, and as far as I'm aware, that was fixed. So from an ABL perspective, David, I think you're safe going OLED. It's actually the potential for burn-in that I'd be thinking about. If you have hockey on the TV 8 to 10 hours a day, 4 or more days a week, that score and information ticker down at the bottom of the TV could cause burn-in. But hey, if you're worried about that, you can always get an LG G4 OLED. It's got a 5-year warranty and that covers burn-in. Next question comes from Jay about WCG, which stands for wide color gamut. Jay says, wide color gamut has always been promoted as an advantage of HDR video. Very rarely though, have I ever heard it discussed in TV or video reviews or promoted by TV manufacturers. All the discussion about HDR seems to center on brightness and specular highlights, not the improved colors over SDR. So my question is, do film and video makers have to purposely plan for and shoot in wide color gamut, or do those extra colors just magically appear when watching HDR video? Are we often watching HDR video that does not take advantage of WCG? Thanks for all the questions, Jay. So here's the deal. We often do see HDR and WCG, or wide color gamut, mentioned in the same breath. But in fact, HDR and wide color gamut are not intrinsically linked. Technically speaking, you can have HDR without wide color gamut, and you can have wide color gamut without HDR. But the way content is packaged up, we simply don't see wide color gamut content coming across without HDR. For those unaware, wide color gamut refers to a TV's abilities to produce more colors than was possible from the pre-ultra high definition days. Broadcast, DVD, and standard Blu-ray discs were capped at Rec. 709 color, which is represented here by the smaller of the two triangles. With Ultra HD, we got wide color gamut, which expanded the range of colors out to this larger triangle on this color chart, and we call this color standard DCI P3, or just P3 for short. Oh, and since we're doing acronyms today, I'll mention that the DCI in DCI P3 stands for Digital Cinema Initiatives. So while HDR can have an effect on color brightness and thus color volume, HDR is about dynamic range of brightness and not expanding a color palette. Wide color gamut increases the range of color shades by having a higher bit depth when you increase from 8-bit color to 10-bit color. The content capture side of this, at least for movies, was never a limitation. It's always been the delivery system that was the limitation. 10-bit color requires a lot of storage space or a lot of internet bandwidth to deliver. 4K Blu-rays and modern streaming services made it possible for us to get content with wide color gamut, and it always comes with HDR these days as well. But the TV needs to be able to pull off wide color gamut. That's what makes quantum dots so desirable with LCD TVs. The quantum dots help expand color gamut and color volume by making a more pure white light from which color filters make colors. OLEDs have naturally better color purity and are also capable of wide color gamut. Anyway, hope that's helpful. And for any color scientists out there, please forgive me for watering down this explanation. I'm aware there is a lot more to this topic, but we're trying to keep it at the 101 level here. Roy Rosenthal writes, I enjoy You Asked a lot. My question is about LG MLA technology. All of the reviews make it sound great. My question, is there any downside to MLA? For example, is the off-axis viewing that is so good with regular OLED negatively affected? Or is there any kind of content that MLA doesn't handle well? Or is it just a pure win? So Roy, I've just gotten done testing the LG G4 OLED, which has LG's MLA panel, and near as I can tell, MLA is just a pure win. I don't see any issues inherent to the implementation of the micro lenses that make up MLA, and perhaps that's due to how MLA works. We have a whole explainer on MLA on this channel, but the short version is MLA stands for Micro Lens Array and refers to a layer in certain premium OLED panels that contains billions of tiny lenses, measured in micrometers, by the way. And these lenses help focus light out to the viewer. MLA helps OLED TVs be brighter simply by funneling light out to the viewer, which is typically scattered and lost. It's like reclaimed light output, and it doesn't appear to be getting in the way of anything at all. Bruce McCartney Philgate writes in with questions about eARC, which stands for Enhanced Audio Return Channel. Bruce's question is around why he so commonly hears reviewers, such as myself, complaining about a TV's eARC port taking up one of a TV's HDMI 2.1 ports when he thinks that would be an advantage for folks using an AV receiver as a video switcher. And Bruce, you're right. For anyone who's gonna use an HDMI 2.1 capable AV receiver as a video switcher, which means one would plug in all their source devices like game consoles, Blu-ray players, streaming boxes, and maybe a cable or satellite box, it would be an advantage for the TV's eARC port to also be an HDMI 2.1 port. Also, for those of you not familiar with eARC or ARC in general, audio return channel is what allows an HDMI connection to be a two-way street. Normally, HDMI cables carry signal in one direction, from a source to a display or sound device. It gets a signal from point A to point B, but ARC or ARC and eARC or eARC allow for a video and audio signal to go one way, we'll call it upstream, and for an audio signal to go the opposite way, we'll call that downstream. This way, folks can get sound from their TV, whether it's from the TV's built-in apps or from any devices connected to the TV, the sound can get down to a soundbar or receiver. And finally, the E in eARC stands for enhanced, and it just means that it can carry more information, so you can get lossless, uncompressed audio down the pipeline. Now, a quick reminder for everyone here, the only devices that occasionally need an HDMI 2.1 port are the Xbox Series X or S, the PlayStation 5, or a high-end gaming PC. And that's because those are the only devices that can offer 4K image resolution at 120 Hertz. So they need the extra bandwidth afforded by HDMI 2.1. All the other stuff out there really only needs HDMI 2.0. So if you had more than one of those three devices and an AV receiver, then you would be happy that the eARC port was also HDMI 2.1. But for a lot of folks, that eARC port is gonna be used with a soundbar or perhaps an AV receiver or preamp processor that does not handle HDMI 2.1. In these cases, anyone who has more than one of those special devices that need HDMI 2.1, then you would want them to be free on your TV independent of the eARC port, because all the eARC port needs to do is get great audio to the soundbar, receiver, or pre-pro. That's it for this week's episode of You Asked. I hope you found it helpful. Either way, would you leave a comment with your thoughts down below? That engagement helps us tremendously. Slap that like button if you enjoyed the video. Subscribe if you want to see me in your feed every Sunday and other days as well. I'll see you on the next one from the next hotel. And until then, here's two other videos I think you might like. Got freaking lightsaber vibes up in here.